Music has probably had the most hectic career, not excepting sound, of all mediums which combine to make a motion picture. The present use of music in heightening the emotion of a film was borrowed directly from the elaborate orchestral accompaniment in motion picture theaters during the silent days. No theater was too small to hire a regular orchestra. But with the advent of talking pictures, recorded music, both vocal and instrumental, was used sparingly at first, as was the dialogue. In some instances, an entire picture would be silent, and suddenly in the fourth or fifth reel, someone would burst into song, as in the pagan love song.
Come with me where moonbeams light Tahitian skies and the starlit water.
The theater orchestra still played the accompaniment up to the time the soundtrack was used, leading up to the particular key in which the song was being played. Then, as soon as the recorded music was over, the orchestra would start playing again, leading away from it gracefully. A year or so prior to that time, the Vita phone short subjects came into vogue. In these, a large orchestra of symphonic strength was assembled and photographed while recording the music. In some instances, close-ups of the players were shot and vocalists added. These photographed orchestra novelties would then be shown instead of comedics, scenic subjects, or cartoons.
Wait a minute. You ain't heard nothing yet. Wait a minute, I tell you. You ain't heard nothing.
California, here I come. Right back.
The economic distress in which musicians found themselves after the advent of talking pictures was somewhat counteracted by a miniature gold rush to California. Well-known musicians and orchestra leaders were brought to Hollywood, and the march of recorded pictures began in earnest. For reasons which I will later explain, there was very little underscoring background music in those days, but chiefly main and end titles, opening and closing music. Recorded music was deemed necessary only for musical productions, such as Rio Rita, The Street Singer, The Rogue Song, and Vagabond Lover. Insurmountable difficulties confronted musicians in those days in successfully transferring even a small part of the actual sound onto the soundtrack. The reasons were numerous producers and directors did not know how to handle music. Sound men and musicians were inexperienced. The microphone was in its infancy, and therefore, the entire technical staff went into contortions to reproduce, even in part, what was actually heard on the set. I remember, during the filming of a certain picture, that it took us 2 days to find a suitable spot for the double bass, as the acoustical conditions on the stage were such that every time the bass player touched his instrument, the soundtrack would overshoot, distort, or blur. This experience with the entire company actors, singers, and musicians on the set cost the company $75,000. At that period, the musicians were required to play very softly. The modern recording orchestra, however, plays in a normal tone, and through the use of special microphones, a great part of the orchestra balance is now maneuvered by the recordist. In the old days, one of the great problems was standard actual recording, as dubbing or re-recording was unknown at that time. It was necessary at all times to have the entire orchestra and vocalists on the set day and night. This was a huge expense when one considers that a musician was, and still is, paid $30 for three and $50 for 6 hours recording, with half pay for rehearsals. But because of inexperience and the very undeveloped technique of sound, it was impossible to work fast. Many rehearsals and many recordings takes were necessary before a satisfactory result could be obtained. I have known of instances where one short number of 2 or 3 minutes duration would take 2 days to record. As sound technique gradually improved, this loss of time was considerably lessened until it became so far advanced that today a 3-minute number can easily be recorded in 1 hour or less, if properly rehearsed and balanced, which of course must still be done carefully. At this time, music for dramatic pictures was only used when it was actually required by the script. A constant fear prevailed among producers, directors, and musicians that they would be asked, "Where does the music come from?" Therefore, they never used music unless it could be explained by the presence of a source like an orchestra, piano player, phonograph, or radio, which was specified in the script. To get back to musical pictures, the success of the early musicals like Broadway Melody, Rio Rita, The Street Singer, and The Rogue Song caused every company to concentrate on the production of this type of picture, and fabulous salaries were paid to singers and musicians. It was prosperity at its peak for the chosen few, but, even as at present, the cycle of musicals was overproduced. Lack of sufficient good material and the ever-changing taste of a fickle public, musical picture after musical picture failed, and the studios decided to call it a day and go back to dramatic pictures. It therefore became unnecessary to maintain a large staff of musicians. And so in September 1930, I received a letter telling me that the studio would not require our services any longer and to dismiss everyone not under contract. In most instances, the studios even tried to buy up existing contracts. Musical activity in Hollywood was almost at a standstill. But in the spring of 1931, due to the rapid development of sound technique, producers and directors began to realize that an art which had existed for thousands of years could not be ruled out by the stroke of a pen. They began to add a little music here and there to support love scenes or silent sequences, but they felt it necessary to explain the music pictorially. For example, if they wanted music for a street scene, an organ grinder was shown. It was easy to use music in nightclubs, ballrooms, or theater scenes, as here the orchestra played a necessary part in the picture. Many strange devices were used to introduce the music. For instance, a love scene might take place in the woods, and in order to justify the music thought necessary to accompany it, a wandering violinist would be brought in for no reason at all. Or again, a shepherd would be seen herding his sheep and playing his flute to the accompaniment of a 50-piece symphony orchestra. Half of this music was still recorded on the set, causing a great deal of inconvenience and expense. Whenever the director, after the completion of his picture, made any changes or recut his film, the score was usually ruined, as it was obviously impossible to cut the soundtrack without harming the underlying continuity of the music. Occasionally, we were able to make cuts that were not too noticeable. At this time, the process of re-recording was slowly being perfected, and we soon learned to score music after the completion of a picture. This had two advantages. It left the director free to cue his picture any way he pleased without hurting our work, and we were able to control the respective levels between dialogue and music, thereby clearing the dialogue. To go back to 1931, with re-recording being rapidly improved, every studio again began to import conductors and musicians. At the time, I was general musical director for RKO Studios. I wrote Symphony of 6 Million and Bird of Paradise soon after, the first of which had about 40% and the latter 100% musical scoring. Both pictures had been shot for music. The directors and producers wanted music to run throughout. And this gradual change of policy resulted in giving music its rightful chance. One-third to one-half of the success of these pictures was attributed to the extensive use of music. After that, many pictures were completely scored, one of which was King Kong. This score I wrote in 2 weeks, and the music recording cost was around $50,000. The picture was successful, and the studio again attributed at least 25% of its success to the music, which made the artificially animated animals more lifelike, the battle and pursuit scenes more vivid. After this, other studios followed suit and began to score their pictures. At this time, I wrote the music for The Lost Patrol, directed by John Ford. Mr. Ford also directed The Informer, and he and I conferred on the use of music for this picture before it was shot. This was not the case with The Lost Patrol. At first, it was not intended to have any music, but after the picture was finished, the producer decided that, because of the long silent scenes, it was necessary to underscore the entire production. In order to explain the modern technique and procedure of composing, directing, and recording music for the screen, I will outline my way of scoring, which may differ to some extent from the systems adopted by composers and directors in other studios, but the fundamentals are the same. When a picture is finished and finally edited, it is turned over to me. Then I time it, not by stopwatch, however, as many do. I have the film put through a special measuring machine and then a cue sheet created, which gives me the exact time to a split second in which an action takes place or a word is spoken, as in the following example on screen now.
Yes? Yes. Right. MacPhillip was killed, trying to escape, sir.
£20. You'd better count it. Show him out the back way.
By comparing the respective timing, the reader will be able to discern the method of underscoring. The music for each cue is timed exactly by the number of feet and extra frames, and by the number of minutes and seconds each cue runs. While these cue sheets are being made, I begin to work on themes for the different characters and scenes, but without regard to the required timing. During this period, I also digest what I have seen and try to plan the music for this picture. There may be a scene that is played a shade too slowly, which I might be able to quicken with a little animated music, or to a scene that is too fast. I may be able to give a little more feeling by using slower music. Or perhaps the music can clarify a character's emotion, such as intense suffering, which is not demanded or fully revealed by a silent close-up, as for instance, the scene in the charge of the Light Brigade, where Errol Flynn forges the order, sending 600 to their death. After my themes are set and my timing is completed, I begin to work. I run the picture reel by reel again to refresh my memory. Then I put my stopwatch on the piano and try to compose the music that is necessary for the picture within the limits allowed by this timing. For instance, for 15 seconds of soldiers marching, I may write martial music lasting 15 seconds. Then the picture might cut to a scene at a railroad track, which lasts for 6 seconds, when I would change my music accordingly, or let it end at the cut. Once all my themes are set, I am apt to discard them and compose others, because frequently, after I have worked on a picture for a little while, my feeling towards it changes. Having finally set my themes, I begin the actual and tedious work of composing according to my cue sheets, endeavoring to help the mood and dramatic intent of the story as much as possible. The great difficulty lies in the many cut sections, different locations which make up a modern motion picture. For example, the first 2 minutes on my imaginary cue sheet consist of the arrival of a train in some little town. I would use music that conforms with the pounding of the locomotive, a train whistle or the screeching of the brakes, and perhaps some happy music to cover the greetings of people getting on and off the train. After these 2 minutes, the picture cuts directly to the deathbed of the father in a little attic in an outlying farmhouse, the scene lasting 3 minutes in all. I must therefore devise some method of modulating quickly and smoothly from the happy music in the station to the silence and tragedy in the death room. These two scenes would consume 5 minutes of the 10-minute reel, and at the point of the father's death, we might cut directly to a cabaret in New York, where the daughter is singing, not knowing that her father is dead. Here is a transition which I would not modulate at all. Instead, it would be very effective to let a hot jazz band bang right in as soon as the cut, or short fade to the cabaret, was completed. Nothing more effective in motion picture music than sudden changes of mood, cleverly handled, providing, of course, they are consistent with the story. During the cabaret scene, while the jazz orchestra is playing, if the daughter is notified of her father's death, it would be absolutely wrong to change from the hot tune in progress to music appropriate to her mood. We must consider the jazz orchestra as actual music, not as underscoring, and in order to make this sequence realistic, we should contrive to make the music as happy and noisy as possible. For in the first place, the orchestra leader does not know what has happened and would therefore have no reason to change his music. And second, no greater counterpoint has ever been found than happy music underlying a tragic scene or vice versa. The latter, of course, applies only if the audience is aware of tragedy taking place unknown to the players. Standard symphonic music, such as Beethoven's Eroica, should not be used in its entirety for the same reasons stated in my last paragraph. The change of locale and cutting back and forth make it almost impossible. For example, if I were to use a funeral march from the Eroica, however well it might fit the scene and mood, if the picture cut on the 12th bar to a cabaret in the Bronx, what would I do with the funeral march by Beethoven? I would have to rewrite, discontinue, or break it up in some way, and I, for one, am loath to recompose the old masters. Furthermore, it is my conviction that familiar music, however popular, does not aid the underlying score of a dramatic picture. I believe that while the American people are more musically minded than any other nation in the world, they are still not entirely familiar with all the old and new masters' works. I am therefore opposed to the use of thematic material that might cause an audience to wonder and whisper and try to recall the title of a particular composition, thereby missing the gist and significance of a whole scene, which might be the key to the entire story. Of course, there are many in our industry who disagree with my viewpoint. In composing a score, there are certain facts which I have found important to consider. For instance, it pays to watch the particular pitch in which a person talks. A high voice often becomes muddy with high-pitched musical accompaniment, and the same is true of the low pitch. I rarely combine these except when I want to attain a special effect, such as matching voice and orchestra, so that one is indistinguishable from the other. The speed of the dialogue is also of great importance to the modern motion picture composer. Fast music over a slow dialogue scene may help to speed up the action, but it may also ruin the mood, whereas slow music over a slow scene may either fit admirably or retard the action to an unprecedented extent. I rarely use fast music over fast dialogue. Instead, I try to punctuate a fast-moving dramatic scene with music which seems to be slower, but which in reality approximates the same speed.
Reputation will be lost forever.
There's enough courage you can do without a reputation.
Oh, you do talk scandalous. You do waltz divinely, Cap Butler.
Don't start flirting with me. I'm not one of your plantation foes. I want more than flirting from you.
What do you want?
I'll tell you, Scarlett O'Hare. You'll take that Southern Belle simple off your face. Someday I want you to say to me the words I heard you say to Ashley Wilkes. I love you.
That's something you'll never hear from me, Captain Butler, as long as you live.
Pronounced high solo instruments or very low ones, or sharp or strident effects, oboe, piccolo, muted trumpets, screaming violins, xylophone, bells, high clarinets, and muted horns. Fortissimo are taboo with me, because we should be able to hear the entire combination of instruments behind the average dialogue. But I have found muted strings, harp, celeste, and low woodwind effects to be successful. Of course, there are exceptions to this rule, and in many of my pictures I have broken it entirely. In fact, by now you may say, "What's the matter with Steiner?" In one breath, he gives advice and sets down a rigid rule, and in the next, he reverses it. That is true. There are no rules, and there won't be as long as music continues to assume more and more importance in pictures, and the development of sound continues to make such rapid strides.
Thank you.
composed and orchestrated, the orchestra assembles on a sound stage, especially treated for acoustics. The modern music recording stage has soft and hard flats panels, which can be moved around the stage on rollers at will to accommodate the different orchestral and vocal sounds produced. The reason for the flexibility of these flats is the varying sizes of orchestras and choruses required to score a motion picture. Naturally, inside a theater, an orchestra has a different tone quality than it would have out of doors. And by the same token, a singer in a fairly small room would sound entirely different than the same singer in a large concert hall. In order to reproduce these tone qualities as closely as possible, these flats are moved around either to reduce or enlarge the size of the tone space required. Often these flats are not used at all, particularly when the orchestra or chorus is very large. The monitor booth is usually located on the first floor, out of everyone's way. That is the room in which the recorder sits and manipulates the various dials channels which combine the different microphones and thereby produce the final orchestra soundtrack. This recordist, in most instances, is himself a former musician, or at least a person who has great interest in music. His work is tedious and of great responsibility because of the enormous expense incurred during the recording of the picture, involving musician salaries and film expense. If one considers that the orchestra may have to do 10 to 20 takes of the same number in order to get one good recording, one can imagine the time involved, not to speak of the thousands of feet of film needed. A good take can easily be spoiled by the noise of an overhead airplane. Many times, mail planes pursuing their duty swoop a little too low over the recording stage during a very tender violin solo. And of course, this recording cannot be used, as the most modern microphones are extraordinarily sensitive. Also, accidents occur, such as the scraping of a chair, the dropping of a mute or a bow, or even the scraping of a shirt button on a stand, the swish of music sheets being turned over, or an unavoidable cough. It is not always a wrong note or a conductor's mistake which causes a take to go wrong. Sometimes the projection machine freezes, gets out of order, and it may take 15 or 20 minutes to repair. With a 50-piece orchestra, the expense is about $250 in unused salaries for this 20-minute delay, as the musician gets paid from the time he is called until he leaves, whether he plays or not.
Jerry, don't let us ask for the moon. We have the stars.
get back to our first rehearsal of a new picture. The orchestra is rehearsed a little more thoroughly than other orchestras, for the better an orchestra plays, the less takes will be required and the less money spent on salaries and film. During this rehearsal, the recordist places his microphones according to the wishes of the conductor, who indicates what instruments or orchestra sections shall be specially emphasized or mic'd. Then, when this is accomplished, while someone else conducts, the conductor goes upstairs to the booth to determine whether everything is to his liking. If it is, we then record our first take. Of course, long association between recordists and conductors results in tremendous speed and balancing. I work with recordists whom I trust so implicitly that I rarely go up into the booth unless the recordist asks for advice. After our first take, we play it back. That means a loudspeaker plays back the record that has been made on a separate recording machine, but which reproduces exactly the same result as on the film itself. It stands to reason that we cannot replay an undeveloped film, for first of all, the negative would be spoiled, and second, we would need a dark room for unloading, loading, and rewinding. Should this playback be satisfactory, we go into our next sequence, rehearsal again, and we proceed exactly as before. We make as many takes as necessary until we get a perfect recording. Each film is divided into sections of 1,000 feet, and one such section is called a reel. A modern feature film consists of approximately 9 to 10,000 feet. The latest projection machines in the theaters are able to run films of 2,000 feet each, which are simply the first and second 1,000-foot reels spliced together. However, the laboratories only develop 1,000-foot reels. In recording music, we divide a reel into as many sections as possible, for it is much easier for musicians and conductor to remember a 2-minute scene than a 10-minute one. In writing the music and recording it, great care must be taken by orchestra and conductor that the overlaps are properly handled, so that when the film is finally completed, the listener is not conscious of the breaks. With our first day's recording over, we await the next morning with great expectation, or shall I say, anxiety, when the laboratory sends the developed and printed recordings back to the studio for us to hear and pick takes. We sometimes print 2 or 3 recordings of the same number to be on the safe side, and in some instances intercut from one to the other. For instance, in a composition of 120 bars duration, the first 90 bars may be perfect, whereas the last 30 may have been spoiled by any one of the aforementioned factors. Our profession is not always a bed of roses and looks much easier to the layman than it really is. The work is hard and exacting, and when the dreaded release date is upon us, sleep is a thing unknown. I have had stretches of work for 56 consecutive hours without sleep in order to complete a picture for the booking date. The reason for this is the fact that the major film companies sell their pictures for a certain date before they have even been produced. And if the film's final editing has been delayed through some unforeseen happening, the music and re-recording departments have to pitch in to make up for lost time. After we have picked our developed takes, which have been returned by the laboratory, and providing everything is satisfactory, these takes are turned over to the music cutter, and he synchronizes them to the film and dialogue track. When these tracks have finally been set up, the entire film is taken up to the re-recording room. There, both dialogue and music are mixed and regulated. Again, numerous takes are made, and impurities of the film and soundtracks are ironed out. These re-recording sessions are every bit as tedious and painstaking as the original recordings, since they constitute the final product. The next day, when these re-recorded takes come back from the laboratory, the same procedure of picking the best takes is followed. This time, of course, more attention is paid to the ratio between dialogue, music, and sound effects. Then, some evening, the picture is given a sneak preview at some obscure theater where only the highest executives are allowed to witness its initial showing.
Thank you.
The studio management thereby wishes to prevent any unfavorable opinion from penetrating the papers before the final editing. Should the projection equipment have been in mediocre or very bad condition, the sound and music departments would be the butt of unfavorable criticism. Happily for us, all picture theaters, including the small neighborhood houses, are gradually buying or renting new first-class standard equipment. I have often been asked, what are the requirements that make for a competent film composer-conductor? I would answer, ability, good disposition, patience. 1,001 things can happen to a music soundtrack from the time it leaves the composer's brain until it is heard by the audience. I have had pictures which did not require any music whatsoever, according to the producers. Some of these turned out to be 100% underscoring jobs. On other pictures, I was told that a certain film could not be released without an entire underscoring job, and I would work for weeks, day and night. When the finished product left the studio to go to the exchanges, only 60% of all the music written remained. Many factors caused this: a bad preview reaction, very bad sound, the unfortunate presence of a director or producer who might still be opposed to the use of music throughout, or dialogue that may have been recorded too softly at the outset so that no music could be heard at the low level required to keep this dialogue intelligible. In some instances, a composer or musical director himself may feel that music did not help a particular scene. This is not always easy to recognize in the studio projection room because of the absence of any audience reaction. Besides, one who works to a film is apt to get so used to the dialogue that he knows it by heart and therefore does not miss any part of it during the multitude of runnings which are required to complete the job.
Play it once, Sam, for all time's sake.
I don't know what you mean, Miss Elsa.
Play as time goes by.
Oh, I can't remember it, Miss Elsa. I'm a little rusty on it.
I'll hum it for you. Sing it, Sam.
You must remember this. A kiss is just a kiss. A sigh is just a sigh. The fundamental things apply as time goes by. And when two lovers woo, they still say I love you. On that you can rely. No matter what the future brings, as time goes by.
Sam, I thought I told you never to play.
It took me 3 months to write the music for the film Gone with the Wind. I loved scoring that picture, and I thought it was one of the greatest films I ever saw.
Red, you go. Where shall I go? What shall I do?
Frankly, my dear, I don't give a damn.
As for my legacy, I'll let others decide that.